priests, faith deacons, religious men and women, other distinguished guests, my fellow workers of life, dear brothers and sisters in Christ. In this seating here in the sanctuary this morning, I recall that the last time I was here was the Feast of St. Patrick in 2020. Everything shut down right after that. It's good to be back. Most of us wear masks. A few things have happened since then. We had a new Archdiocese of Ottawa coronated on May 6, 2020. The new coadjutor Archbishop was named, Archbishop Marcel Campus, and we celebrated the retirement of Archbishop of Ottawa Cornwall after 6 months of service on the 4th of December. But 5 days before that, I was asked to be the Apostolic and History Advisor of the First Lucidity, just to keep me busy in my time. So I'm happy to be back here for a few days. I came for the ordination of Michael Chaff. Matt Chaff has a deacon on the way to the priesthood on May 6th. And I'm going to be ordaining four Jesuits to the diaconate on Saturday in Toronto. So, given the fact that there was an opening for a bishop here, I was happy to volunteer. Thank you to Monsignor Beach and Father Steve and Deacon and all the team here for welcoming me. In the past, Cardinal Collins regularly accepted to come to Ottawa for the Martyrs of Life and preside at Holy Mass here at St. Patrick's Basilica. Due to other pressing concerns, His Eminence is not able to preside this year. He graciously sent a message to us to encourage us. Although I'm not able this year to participate in the Ottawa March of Life and celebrate the Mass at St. Patrick's, as I have done for many years, I will offer Mass for this intention in Toronto. In our current situation, it is especially important to pray for the protection of human life from the first moment of conception until natural death. We see much contention elsewhere, but the situation in Canada is also grave, not only regarding abortion, but also the rapid extension of euthanasia. Prayer and sacrifice are the foundation of our witness, a silent and loving witness, so much in contrast to the violent ferocity of those who oppose the right to life. In their ferocity, they unconsciously reveal the falseness of their cause. We must also use the gift of reason which God has given us in order to strengthen effectively any protection for conscience and the dignity of human life, and also with clarity and charity to get through the blindness of those who oppose our witness to the sanctity of life and vocation. As he prays with us and for us today, I assured His Eminence that we would pray him especially on Saturday, on which he will mark the silver jubilee of his ordination as a bishop, as well as fortuitously the golden anniversary of his ordination as a deacon. We pray that his time remaining in service to the Church of Toronto, Canada, his forthcoming retirement, whenever that will be, will truly be days of thanksgiving to God for his ministry, which has been a blessing for him personally and for all who benefit from his wisdom and courage, as well as his pastoral leadership, especially here in the cause of life. Not only here in St. Patrick's for the Mass, but also on the Hill. We always have a very profound message to offer. Today's Mass, dear brothers and sisters, continues our Eastertide readings from the Acts of the Apostles and the Gospel of John. When we read or hear proclaim the Acts of the Apostles, we have the tendency sometimes to telescope the many events of these brave men and women and see them as taking place in a very abbreviated timeline. The exact opposite is the case. You see, it was for decades after his conversion to Christ that St. Paul labored in service of the Lord Jesus. Tramped across the dusty roads for years in the Near East, especially in Turkey and Greece. He endured beatings, stoning, shipwreck, imprisonment, rejection, opposition, and indifference, as we do today for the cause of life. The passage from the Acts that we have just heard Paul and Barnabas are carrying out the ministry of preaching as the deacons and priests being ordained in various dioceses during this month, also called True shepherds following the footsteps of Jesus, their ministries that proclaim the gospel of Christ with joy. Paul and Barnabas do this in Antioch and Pisidia, which is a starting point of what we know as the first missionary voyage. You can trip the maps in the back of your Bible. We have three trips of Paul across the Middle East. There they proclaim the gospel of Jesus to mixed congregation made up of Jews and Gentiles. Some of the Gentiles were called God-fearers, that is, people sympathetic to the teachings of the God of Israel in the Torah and the prophets, but who were unable to convert to biblical faith because of the consequences for them in their careers or social family relationships. As we will hear in the second half of the episode tomorrow, the early preaching of the gospel met with resistance and persecution. It led the apostles to make a limited number of converts there to bond to the other cities and towns. Today, the gospel is more likely to meet with indifference. Lately, we also note an increasing hostility towards the gospel of life, as they see us stand in favor of life in the womb at the end of life. You should note that throughout the ages and even today, the church supports more people in need, pregnant women included, than any other institution. Extremists hate us for the same reason that people hate Jesus. They reminded them of what God wanted of them. In these difficult circumstances, the church and the people of goodwill were open to the dignity of all human life, need to be open to God's Spirit as we seek to find new and creative ways to proclaim God's love for the world, who is made known in the death and resurrection of Christ. We pray that as a result in our days in the past, people may be glad and praise the word of the Lord. Later on in the Acts of the Apostles, when Paul went to Athens and gave a brilliant defense of the faith to the premier philosophers and thinkers of his day, he got laughed at. The apostle also sought to speak to the people of his day and seemingly received no response, maybe even notice. We increasingly find similar reactions as we resist the banalization of death, the so-called medical aid in dying. And I draw your attention to a statement made by Bishop this week, opposing any extension of the criteria that made. Paul persevered in his missionary enterprise. Some people listened, became heroes in their own right. Lay people, the Selenite, for example. The number of followers grows, the light of a new reality begins to cast its rays upon a darkened world. The gospel today, after a number of earlier chapters in John's gospel, we begin to read from the Last Supper discourse. Jesus begins by challenging us with his prophetic teaching. He says that as his disciples, we cannot expect to be treated differently from him. I tell you, servants are not greater than their masters, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. This is a call for us to action. Jesus doesn't promise an easy time, but he offers us great encouragement. We will weep and mourn, but the world will rejoice. You will have pain, but your pain will turn to joy. All of us are here today, knowing it's difficult work that we have undertaken. But already we can see signs of hope, especially in the large number of young people who are open to the message of life. Their presence at the March for Life in recent years is a wonderful, hopeful signal. Those who have been toiling for years, even decades, affirm and protect life. Whether the message is delivered to Jews or Gentiles, or to the world of Jesus and his apostles, or to the people of the will of our day, the power of truth can touch the plain hearts of believers, our hearts. In a long, arduous task lies in front of us, all of us. The power of truth is not immediately evident to all who hear it. The power of truth triumphs over deceit, lies, and ignorance, even as Christ will triumph over the grave. Today, I invite you to continue to walk with Christ for truth. Whether the message he brings is accepted or not, we walk with Christ. In spite of being forced out of the mainstream, we walk with Christ in arduous battles, debates, long vigils at the end of telephone lines. Parliament Hill, there, streets of Ottawa, but not only here, in several provincial capitals today, the Rock of Christ, the testament of humanity of all persons, born and pre-born, ill and well, old and young. We gather as enemies signed with funny numbers to declare the truth cannot be conveniently compartmentalized or put aside. We come together to speak out of the against the crimes against humanity, abortion, and mercy killing. We are here to continue long road, build a new culture of life in our day, this both in our nation and in our 21st century world. I ask you to continue, persevere with courage and fortitude for the cause of life. Continue to walk with Christ and bear his message of life and truth. Parliament Hill, schools, campuses, homes, and our hospitals. Look at the hard work to build up this new culture of life that you all do. And know that the Bishops of Canada and I, on their behalf, sincerely thank you for what you are doing and what you will do. God bless you all.